Oh, yeah. Well, you never know. Like, I thought I would get it. I didn't look at it.
Well, thank you for bringing the shoes.
I don't know, like, mine might be Eric's, and I'm okay.
Holy cow. The internet is... Something went wrong.
Oh, no.
Something went wrong. You don't know your own user ID. That's not good. And then it's dead. Hey, it works.
Well, I checked the grade book for that non-math class.
She wanted to find me.
She was very blind.
She's having a baby.
Did she have her?
Nerve for not letting us know.
And I'm going to be a cook on Donald. Okay, so Ulu in Hawaii. Parrot fishes are called Ulu in Hawaii. They inhabit shallow tropical seas around the world. And they're easily recognized because of their parrot-like beak. Elongated head, large scales, and brilliant colors. And they're noisy eaters, and you can hear them eating underwater. And after they eat, they expel a stream of sand as much as a ton per year per fish. And in fact, most of Hawaii's white sandy beaches are made out of parrot fish. The lulu is very consumed in the continental United States, but it's a delicacy in many other parts of the world, especially in Hawaii. And in Polynesia, it's served raw and was once considered a royal food that was only eaten by the king. And parrot fishes have been difficult to classify and name because, like grass, they show different color patterns according to their age and their sex. So they all parrotfish start out drab and boring because their colors are dull. Beautiful colors emerge when the female swaps sexes and transitions into a male. So the bright greedy cutters and territorial supermales dominate the best spawning sites, and each supermale controls a harem of females whom he individually spawns with. And when he dies, the next top ranking female changes sex to takes over. And he's the king of the castle. The Wu is a favorite dish of Arctic Hawaiians, and there are Hawaiian names for different sizes and color forms of the parrot fish. The prominence of the Hawaiian leeks is reflected by the Hawaiian legends. For instance, some of the Hawaiian fishermen in the past believed that the Wu behavior was a hint for what was happening in the ocean, and keepering and frolicking Wu might mean that their Wu was truly around them. So the native, these are the set of native ones that are found here in Hawaii. The first one is the star-eyed parrotfish, or pōnumu, and has a bright blue face and a pink star and pink stripes. I don't know, when I was growing up, I thought it was called Honolulu, but it's not. That's just weird. I'll give it a wrong. Okay, another one is a yellow bar parrotfish, primarily blue with bright yellow or white stripes behind the pearl fin. And the male shows the yellow stripes, the female shows the white stripes. And they also have a pinkish marking on the bottom jaw. Spectacle of the parrotfish. Hawaiian name is Umu Ahaula. They're purplish brown with a red tail, and the males are called Umu Uili. These are blue with a purple overlay, so that's the male right there. And they also have yellow marks on the pectoral fins. Both genders have saddle-like bars just ahead of their eyes. That big straight up in the middle. The Kolehe parrotfish, which is just called Umu, are most common of the large parrotfish that you see here. The males have yellow and orange centers with surrounding markings, and the female are reddish brown with a series of white spots towards the rear and red markings on the mouth. The regal parrotfish, called the Lauia, are also seen frequently. Females are pale to red with light stripes on the belly, and the males are salmon, pink, and orange turquoise, like that's the one. And the pale nose Wu, which is also just called a Wu, are mostly blue and yellow and pink. The females are mottled gray with olive brown, and this variety is less than 10 inches long. The last one is the red lip parrotfish, or the Uhu Palupalupo. They have blunt angular heads, and the males are green and turquoise, or purple with two color schemes, and the females are purple with brown skin. Yeah. So this is the female.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about the rates. So like when they were talking about, when they reproduce, they reproduce in harems with other females, and sometimes they can even have a full dozen of them. So like some people would nickname them the ladies' men, which is also because they have so many female partners. So when they reproduce, the females, release their eggs, and then the males have to follow them and fertilize the eggs. That's one way, and then the other way is that they have to find open territory, and then they have to show ownership of functioning in that area. Sometimes in the harem there's multiple men, but then whoever's the second fish, they become subservient to the first fish. The period that they reproduce is usually in late spring and early summer because the water's a lot of the right temperatures. It's not too hot and it's not too cold, but the older Uhu actually reproduce year round. And everything's in really large numbers because they have so many partners. And then
So, Dr. Alan M. Friedlander from the University of Kentucky, he said, this is the most compelling evidence that overfishing is the primary driver of reef fish declines in the main Hawaiian Islands based on the most robust data sets ever put together for Hawaii and perhaps the world. These people did an image where they ran a test along all the coral reefs on the island, and they wanted to see what exactly was causing the decline in the coral fish, especially the pool, and the main cause was the overfishing. The decline started somewhere between the 1970s and 1990s. They didn't have one exact date. And other factors that helped destroy the reefs were from humans. So things like walking on the coral, sewage pollution, and then just scarce resources. So the high populated areas on Oahu and Maui, they didn't have enough coral because there's a lot of people there. So there wasn't abundant. There wasn't a high abundance of anything. And the low populated areas, Niihau, Molokai, Koho Lawe, there was lots of coral everywhere because they didn't have human contact, so nobody was damaging the reefs.
I'm sure it's all going to be talking about the fishing regulations for Ukulele on Maui and Oahu in the next couple of slides. So, basically, Ukuleles are generally known as a parrotfish because of the hard reef that we talked about earlier. And basically, the Ukulele lady and the Ukulele lily cannot be understood. These are the male uhus in Maui. Maui respects that law that you don't want to cut off the male uhus because you're gonna halt the spawning cycle for 1 year if you killed the uhu or the group of uhus that was a male at a certain time. There wouldn't be time for the female uhu to reach the terminal cycle to turn into a male because uhus are hermaphroditic, so they possess both male and female organs, so that's how they can change from the female to the male if they have to. So Maori respects that, and only one person can get two uhus that are not of the uhu alei rehi or uhu uli uli, and it's just no older per day. So you can get two uhus that are not those energies, or bigger per day. So here's a picture of the Ukulele, basically predominantly green and blue, and that's the male, and this is the terminal phase, which is a male. The white man is the tail of the blue of Ukulele, and these are the ones that are restricted. So Oahu has no restrictions on these uhus. And I think it's good for like the fishermen to be educated on this matter. There's so many different types of uhus. You can see how it's not like fishing for sand when everything looks the same. So basically our regulation on Oahu is uhu must be 12 inches, but there's no bag limit. You can catch as many as you want per day, per person, for Oahu. And this is just a map of Oahu, some of the restricted fishing areas that would be restricted for uhu, like Hanawa Bay and some of the Waikiki. And I'm pretty sure there's Okate on the Hawaiian side. So, why is uhu being overfished? They taste really ono, and the human population is great on Oahu and Maui, so there's a lot more fishermen hunting these species versus places like Molokai and Niihau that aren't under as much pressure. And they're easy to catch at night because some fishermen will use like spotlight technique. You know, atmosphere, because that night the guru will encase himself in like a mucus bubble, and they'll just be pretty much sitting there, not moving under the rocks. Every structure is.
How we present them, a fish for Uhu or any fish, it comes down to like their sizes, like how it comes out, maybe 12 inches and per person. Also like the gender of the fish, you can't have the female because they're uncomfortable. And then, and then it's two fish per person per day, not over here, but more Maui can be more strict on it. And then, the update on all regulations, we watched it and increased the length of the boat. And then, I told you on the last slide, but you can have stuff like this, packaged like this, and it's really good, or you can have it cut open and you just store it back. Or like how, I'm going to talk about when they had it back in the HLINE, they had it raw, it's very good on that.
So you know how they said that when we get two to enforce that, is there like a DNR even that's there to speculate that?
We probably have to go to like the meetings and like a lot of people go to the meetings, but they have to update the regulations. I have a copy of the regulations that she has. This is like the Maui and Oahu. There's just a difference, and here's a book that's kind of. And then there's a fish.
So there's a class that you can know which rooms to not take.
Oh, I mean, if you wanted to like crest or Oahu's regulations, they have like monthly meetings but people have to go and like the fishing groups or would want to push for that, and they would have to like update the regulations.
How would a regular person know if they're fishing the wrong fish?
That's why
pictures and you get a license and you get the information.
There's like a fish identification guide, that one that I do, but like even the DNR website or book pamphlet is not in color, so you'd have to basically want to educate yourself.
You'd have to be knowledgeable about it.
Yeah, so it's somebody who knows all the guides and knows all the different fish.
So if you're not
I guess that's the problem. People aren't exactly doing the research itself, so when they go up and the overfishing rate.
So, if this is such an issue, a problem, what would you recommend instead of what's currently in practice?
I mean, they could do like rotating like more areas that would be preserved. Like rotate this area every other year, you know what I mean?
Fishing.
Like get on time to build up the, like you can't, spear fishing is the biggest problem for Uhu, like most people don't really fish right now for Uhu, but yeah, spear fishing, and plus it's like hard to measure a fish when you're underwater and you like someone, you know what I mean, it's like hard to know that's 12 inches. And you can't release a fish after you spear it. Might as well.
Maybe they should put like signs up on
the beach.
Yeah,
thank you. But you can, like, so if they sleep at night, it's easy to catch them at night, so they would like diving in, you know, or they probably get tortured. So there's no way to.
Well, the thing is, Oahu has no restrictions on the male Uhu. That was so they would want to, like, update that to
there should be, but there's more people here.
And make it like two fish per day, or even one. Like, there's no need to be more than two fish per day.
So what would happen
then if
all humans were
on the fish and everyone left? What
happened
to the honey
ecosystem?
I mean, good question.
Yeah. Coral would be
recycling depletion. Yeah.
I don't think that would be like a major impact, but there's
almost time. We gotta cover reefs and time cover reefs.
And we'll have tourists, we'll have people coming. So we just, we should do the moon cups.
Yeah,
no, yeah, that is.
Right?
It was effective.
Do you think they're doing, what is that called? Is it aquaculture where they fertilize or they take species?
I've never heard of
Do you think they should?
Yeah, it is possible.
I think their diet is like.
There's a lot of different species, so like the certain ones that breed overfish and take those and do like aquaculture.
In the Maui regulation, is there any stipulation for indigenous people to be able to take more than two? Because like in many Western states, for salmon particularly and trout, tribal members or, you know, whatever the blood quota relationship would be, 25%, 50%, whatever the tribe or the nation decides on, they're exempt from those kinds of laws. How would that work in Hawaii?
I think there was something in there. I just didn't read that. I mean,
because for a lot of local families, it's subsistence. Yeah. I mean, they don't get more than two fish. They don't eat more than two fish. So it'd be an interesting thing to think about what kind of regulation and how would it apply to Hawaiians and how would you be a card-carrying Hawaiian? So that when you got pulled over by DNLR, you pull out your permit that says I can take as many as I want because I've got the blood. Yeah. And they look at me and they go, sorry, dude, you're not card carrying. So, I mean, that's a question, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, another problem I think is like the presence of DNLR and not enforcing.
Yeah.
Like, they don't.
We got stopped over one.
I've been.
Yeah, they came out and they got ruled on that.
No, twice. One hiking and one fishing. That's it. I mean, there's not that many.
Yeah. Well,
there's a lot of beach.
Okay.
You know, they're not there.
Are they even threatened in Oahu though? I mean, if they were, because the numbers really,
well,
they would be higher regulated if they would, because I don't see them doing it.
I just think why not limit taking males because you're just gonna have a better population if you just there's more females anyways, right?
Yeah. I don't think they're threatened yet, but eventually they will be.
It's just because if you kill them during the spawning cycle at the wrong time, you're interrupting that group, that whole spawning cycle for a year because it doesn't give the female chance to change over.
It just seems odd that there's none. Oahu is the most populated island, the most damaged coral beds, and yet we don't have any regulation on them, which is Maui, who have significant less, they have a regulation. So it's just odd that they don't have any regulation here, unless they realize they've done surveys and found they're not threatened here. If they were threatened, I'm pretty sure somebody who would protest and throw down a line.
I don't know, a lot of places there's not that.
I don't see too many politicians in the water.
They don't care. They just won't.
It's a cultural difference too. You know, in places like Molokai, Kohala, but even if they didn't have those restrictions, those people they're not going to overfish.
Yeah.
Because they already understand that they're only going to take this amount so that they still have. Because, like you said, right, a lot of these families, this is their main substance that they're using. So if they were overfish, they're not gonna have anything else. You know, and things like awful because the culture is like that. It's almost opposite, you could say, in a way. So even if those rules are in place, it's gonna be a lot more difficult for them to just one day say, hey, we're not gonna do the same one. You know,
two a day, a size limit's reasonable.
Yeah.
Very good. But like you said about the blood quantum, I think Native Hawaiians got a raw deal compared to the Native Americans in Alaska. You know, it should be equal, but for some reason it is jacked up here.
That's a whole other topic.